This battery good or bad?
That's bad.
Well. Well, today is our congregational meeting afterwards, and we're going to have it out in the gym, and I think we've got some soups we're going to share. It's soup. So, invite everybody to come join us, you know, have some soup, listen to the congregational meeting, and this is the short one. This isn't the 2 hour, 3 hour one. Nope, this is the short one. So we'll have some soup and sandwiches and go from there. Well, next Saturday is our another Awana meeting. And of course, the 31st is our trunk or treat on it. I do want to thank all the people that worked really hard yesterday. I'm looking down the list to see how we did yesterday. We can cross this one off, right? Clean the inside of the reader board, we can cross that off. Paint the crosses, we can cross off. Repair the lights inside the gym, we can cross that off. What does it say?
Pressure wash
outside of the building. We got that accomplished. We put up some of the fence. Repair the parking lot lights. We checked into that.
They still worked.
Isn't that amazing? You know? Repaired the paddle fans. If you don't know, remember last year, one of the kids decided they were going to see how the paddle fan challenge was, and they got it. So we got it repaired. And the only thing we haven't done is put the shield over the projector, but we did go up and tighten up everything on the projector, didn't we? So that it will stay kind of half straight. So I'm amazed at how much stuff got done between 9:30 and 2:30 yesterday. It was a lot that got... Oh, yeah, and we trimmed the trees because we were shading the neighbor's solar panels. So, trimmed that tree. What else did we do yesterday? I don't know. There was a lot. So, I want to thank everybody for that. That was really a lot of accomplishment. Yeah, put up the sign. The reader board really looks nice this morning for those that went all that trouble cleaning it and the inside of it out. Yep. So. Yep. Judy and Susan and Sarah prepared lunch yesterday for us. Yes, that was really good. You know? So, yeah, it was a really accomplishment day. Sam and I got to travel a lot yesterday, didn't we, Sam? We went back and forth from this store to that store getting parts, you know? But we got them. So. On it. Next congregational meeting will be, of course, on November 10th. This will be our harvest dinner. So we will have it. So that one, come prepared, because that meeting lasts a couple hours, sometimes two or three. We go through everything that in that meeting. That's where we have the big dinner. That's right. You know, this one's just to kind of hold us over. 16th. So like I said, and you know, so that kind of gives you a clue. Remember in Bible study, we are in the book of Daniel. So we have been reading through it, which is really good on that because we're getting some nice information out of that. And what else? How many of you are still using Right Now Media? Is anybody using Right Now Media? It's free. It's free to the church, people. Just send me an email and let me know that you want to be part of it. And it has thousands and thousands of videos on there of different Bible studies. Even got some movies on there now. I mean, it is really amazing platform to work from.
Kids,
A lot of kids' Bible stories and stuff on it. So, yeah. So, if you're not part of it, I encourage you guys to use this on and off during the week, you know. Of course, we talked about Medicare last week. Big changes for 2025. Make sure that you, those of us who need to be in part of that, keep track of that. The other one, vote Tuesday, November 5th. I'm not quite sure where all the voting booths are at yet. Hopefully I'll find that out so we can know. Usually this area is the Mormon church, ain't it? Usually over there. And the other one last time for our area was the Mormon church on Ruth Lane, if I remember. That changed again?
Yeah, I'll let you know.
Okay. Well, yes. And I encourage everybody to vote. And I just found out yesterday that Kunick School District is going to close on the 5th of November so people can vote. At least that's what I heard.
Not so they can vote. It's because they have so many people coming in that they're afraid of the safety of children. So, because they use the schools as a voting site, and they said it's because they're concerned for the safety of the children.
And I think West Ada also announced they're closing their schools that day too. So, you know. So this vote is very important for the future of our country. Okay, what else? Christmas shoe boxes have been ordered. So it's time to start thinking about your Christmas shoe boxes. Susan's already one step ahead of us. I think there's already 10 of them back there that have been filled up. Susan did 9. I can't remember who did the 10th one, but I'll remember pretty soon. Anyway, so the boxes will be here in a few days, and in that case, we'll have them out for people to start filling up Christmas shoe boxes. Our goal, of course, is to get at least 25 shoe boxes filled, so we're there right now. So let's see how we did on our reading this week. We actually went through 20, we're going to go through 24 to 27 today, so we're going to do a quick overview of that. But after how many years?
2 years.
Hey, this guy got it right off the bat. 2 years. Pontius, or Festus, succeeded Felix, and Felix wanting to do the who? Who's he trying to do who a favor? Huh? Did I hear the word Jews? Left who? Paul bound. There you go, guys. Okay. Next week, we're going to finish the book of Acts. Acts 28 is the last chapter in the book of Acts. So 24 through 27, if you haven't read it, because all we're going to do today is an overview of those as we go through it. We're not going to spend a lot of time going through it like we did last week. So, Joe, I'm going to turn it over to you. You can get us started. Come on, guys. What's the holdup? Yes, I said, come on, guys. There's a microphone over there you can grab. Joe, you want to unhook that microphone and give them to it? There you go.
Aaron doesn't do it.
Aaron's my backup sound man.
That's true.
Yeah, we are all backups. Because
we
all know how to do it.
You might want to turn Lexi's mic down just a little. It sounds like it's pretty hot.
One Adam. This is Adam.
The one Adam has, which is Lexi's mic, which would be what, mic 2? Yep.
Here we go. Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Who love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the foe with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear the cross, and live alone our life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings the chaos back to order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Just like a son, all of us ravens. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you will take my place. That you would bear my cross, that you'd lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That would lay down your life. So I could be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
We're missing the fourth person in the quartet. Where is he at?
He's all the way in the back corner down there.
Will you bring him up next time? Because the quartet has to have four.
You're right. You're right.
It's not a quartet minus one. Did you hear that, Mr. Quartet, back there? Okay.
Lift him up, lift him up, off the chain of Jesus higher.
Lift him up,
raise his banner to the sky. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Lift him up, all ye people, lift him up. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the righteousness forever. Praise the Lord, lift your voices to the sky. He said that I will praise his name, then his rocks and stones will cry out. Praise the Lord, all ye people, praise the Lord. Show his love, show his love to everybody. Show his love, let your candle always shine. He said that by the love we show, they will know of his disciples. Lift him up, all ye people, show his love. Lift him up, off the name of Jesus higher. Lift him up, raise his banner to the sky. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Lift him up, all ye people, lift him up. Walk with the Lord in the light of his word. What a glory he sheds on our way. Let us show you him to will, that deviseth us still, and with all the will trust and obey. Trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil to achieving grace. Not a grief for a loss, not a frown or a cross, but 'tis blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. And the joy he bestows
are for them who
will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way for to be in Jesus but to trust and obey. His fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey.
Okay, so today we are in Acts 27, 33 through 38. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, "Today is the 14th day you have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take the nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any one of you." And when he had said these things, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then they were all encouraged and also took food themselves. And in all, we were 276 persons on the ship. So when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and threw out the wheat into the sea.
Oh man, that's a pretty short one, Jim.
That's pretty short today.
Can I try to time on that?
No, do you? Yeah, I think, Mike, did you get the long one last week? Was that it? Oh. It says, how can Hurricane Helene and Hurricane Milton compare? Which storm had a worst impact? What is your what would be your answer to that question? I would think Helene was too. And this is what the article is about, just comparing the two of them. It says, two major hurricanes have made landfall in Florida in the past 2 weeks, unleashing their fury and floods across the southeast, whatever that word is. Okay? So, yes, I would think Helene was the worst of the two, but yet we don't know for sure all the damage that Milton take. But isn't that amazing how they both came? And what's really amazing is this. It says, scientists say we are on the brink of irreversible damage. The climate experts say that they assess 35 of the planet's vital signs, and 25 are worse than ever before, including carbon emissions and temperatures both on land and in the seas. Now, I was thinking about this just out of curiosity. You know, says much of the very fabric of life on Earth is imperiled. We have stepped into a critical and unpredictable new phase of the climate crisis. We find ourselves amid an abrupt climate upheaval, a dire situation, it says, never before encountered in the annals of a human existence, warned the scientist who said climate-related disasters are likely to increase dramatically if the current tragedy continues. And you look at that and you go, wow. Sounds pretty doom and gloom to me, don't you? But then, if we've been studying Revelations, it says, the future of humanity hangs in the balance. What else does it say? The researchers warn that ecological overshoot in which the Earth's resources are used up faster than they can regenerate is an inherently unstable state that cannot persist indefinitely. Well, we know it ain't going to persist indefinitely, don't we? On it, carbon monoxide's building up. What happens when we have more carbon monoxide or whatever that thing's called?
Trees grow better.
trees grow better. What do trees give off? More oxygen. So there's a balance there no matter how you look at it, right? Here it is. Commentary, climate change. The scientists don't support the heated rhetoric. We are consistently reminded that we are experiencing a climate crisis, but as a climate scientist, I can tell you this, that's not what the science has shown us so far. Other than modest warnings, there has been little change in any kind of severe weather that can be attributed to global greenhouse gas emissions. And it says you don't have to take my word for it. You can get a hold of the UN. They came up with the same conclusion too on that, didn't they? So, we're reading the book of Revelation. Actually, we've been studying the book of Revelation. In the book of Revelation, it says something very interesting, doesn't it? It says that the weather is going to get warmer. What happens when the weather gets warmer? We have a climate change, don't we? What does it say that the 1,000 years is going to be like during the millennium? It's going to be like it was during the Garden of Eden, right? When we had a climate change and the weather was nice all around the world. And we look at that and go, well, don't we expect some climate change to happen? Of course we do. Hurricanes and hidden agendas, can weather be altered? And this is an interesting one. It says this normally doesn't happen during regular times. A hurricane is not supposed to change from a Category 1 to a Category 5 in what? In less than a day. That's what Milton had that was very unusual about Milton. It went from a 1 to a 5 in one day. At this moment, the roads out of the Temple Bay area are absolutely jammed with vehicles. And this, of course, article came up before it came into, the storm came in. And what did it come into? It went from a 5 to a 3 before it hit shore. And they were surprised by that because it was such a dramatic change also. They would have expected a 5 or a 4 to come on shore because it went from a 1 to a 5 so quick. And yet we're seeing all these changes happen. So what happened? There are some people, says, are placing the blame on our changing climate, but others are pointing out that man-made tools can cause apocalyptic weather events as well. And of course, we know they have been doing cloud seeding and all this stuff. So who knows what went on before that storm hit? I think it was United Arab Emirates. They tried that. They did a cloud seeding. And what happened? They literally flooded the place with rain when it came down. You should see how much rain came down from their cloud seeding that did. So many people believe that maybe there's some help going on out there why we're having such changes in weather. Mob loots freight train of flat-screen TVs in lawless Chicago. Did you know this happened over the weekend? You know? They went in, and it's not like they're stealing any food or anything. What are they stealing? TV sets. Loading them all up. You know what they're going to do with them? They're going to sell them again. Trying to sell them. But this is what we see happening around the country on it. So that just gives you some clues of what's going on. On just a few of the local things around on this. So let's get into our message today. Let's open a word of prayer as we get into it. Father, we do thank you for your word. As we start to finish up on the books of Acts, Lord, we just want to be, oh, Lord, looking at Paul and the life that he's had. What an adventure, Lord. I cannot imagine having to go through all the stuff he did and him being as faithful to you as he has all the way through. So we just praise and glory as we look at even more in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you remember last week, what happened? We were in Jerusalem. He was in Jerusalem how many days? 12 days he was in Jerusalem. That's all it was. He comes to Jerusalem, and in 12 days, and that's even after he goes through the purification process, which is 7 days. He's there 12 days, and they've loaded him up. If you remember, it says, then the soldiers, as they commanded, took Paul and brought him by night to Antipas. And what is that? How many soldiers was there? Do you remember how many soldiers there was? 400 soldiers, right? Remember, 200 here, 200 here, and how many people on horses? 70 or so, that's right, on horses. So all these people that take Paul to the next town to get him away from this Jewish uprising has happened. The next day they left the horsemen to go on with him. In other words, all the soldiers, the 400 soldiers went back and returned to the barracks. Then they came to Caesarea and they delivered a letter to the governor as they had presented Paul to him. And the governor reads it and says, well, Paul, I guess you're going to be staying here a while. And if you remember what we did, talked about in our reading this morning, that little piece that we filled in the blanks, how long was he in Caesarea? Remember, he's in house arrest slash jail type atmosphere. In other words, even though he has a little freedom, he still can't leave the area. You know, he's got a soldier with him all the time. But look, he goes there to get a little trial, to get him this settled. And how long is he there? 2 years. Can you imagine 2 years sitting there waiting for this so-called trial to go on? Acts chapter 24 or 25 here says, then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, you have appealed to Caesar. To Caesar you shall go. And of course, during this meantime, he's met with Festus. He's gone through Festus's trial. The Jews came up to, remember, to Caesarea. He's at Caesarea, has the trial there. They don't determine anything about it. Festus leaves him in jail so he can quiz him. Then another Agrippa comes in. Agrippa looks at him and says, I don't know what this is all about. And then Festus says, I'm leaving you here. And he says, hey, I'm done being the governor. Felix is coming in to be your new governor, so I'm leaving it for Felix to decide what to do with you. Can you imagine this? 2 years he's been sitting there doing this. Acts chapter 26, he goes on. When he had said these things, the king stood up as well as the governor and Bernice and those who sat with them. And when they had gone aside, they talked among themselves, saying, this man is doing nothing deserving of death or chains. But he's been there 2+ years. Then Agrippa said to Festus, this man might have been set free if he not had appealed to Caesar. Now, you remember what we talked about last week? What was a group of Jews about to do to Jesus? Or to Paul? I should take it back. To Paul? Kill him, remember? They got together and said, we're not going to eat or drink until we kill Paul. Well, I'm sure they took a eat or drink because it's been 2 years now, right, on this. So they probably had a little eat. But their quest is not over. They still want to kill Paul. So the last thing they try to do is get Agrippa to take him back to Jerusalem to have this trial one more time. And Paul says, no, I'm not going back. I am not going to go back because those people still plan on killing me, you know. So he appealed to Caesar, and they said to Caesar, you're going to go. So then we get into chapter 27, and the voyage to Rome begins. Now, you should be reading through this stuff because it's quite interesting, all the trials that Paul goes through in these 2 years. And when it was decided that we should sail to Italy, so they said, off you go. So they go looking for a ship. They're going to take him to Rome. They delivered Paul and some other prisoners to one named Julius, a centurion of the Augusta regiment. And he says, hey, you're going to take him to Rome. Let's get to Rome. So they load him on a ship down here near Caesarea. They started on their journey. And if you read, they go to Myra and they go up here to Nidus. They go around here to Salome and those areas right there. Acts 27 says this, now when much time had been spent and sailing was now dangerous because the fast was already over, in other words, the sailing season's already over, Paul advised him saying, men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much less, not only of the cargo and ship, but also our lives. He says, hey, it's not safe to go sailing out there. Now, this guy sailed quite a bit, but these guys should have been smart enough to know better. Nevertheless, the centurion, what was his name? Julius. was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship than by the things spoken by Paul, because he hadn't trusted Paul yet quite. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to sail from there also, if by any means they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, opening toward the southwest and northwest, and winter there. In other words, if we can just make our way from here around to this little harbor over here, we'll be safe for the winter. Well, sounds pretty good to me, don't it? But what happens along the way? Remember the weather, it's not the right season to be sailing. And they start out on their little voyage, as we read in chapter 27. When the south wind blew softly, supposed that they obtained their desire, putting out to sea, they sailed close to Crete, which is that island that we looked at. But not long after, a temperous head wind arose called Euroclydon. Now, what is a Euroclydon? Yeah, it's a hurricane. We call it a hurricane in our country, don't we? Or a typhoon if you're over in this part of the country. If you're along the Pacific in the upper part, it's called a hurricane. If you're down here, it's called a cyclone. Did you know that? But it's all the same thing. Euroclydon was the name given to a violent wind that can suddenly blow across the Mediterranean Sea. Euroclydon blows from the northeast to the southwest and heavily during the fall and winter months. So this is normal. But yet, basically, it's the same thing we deal with when storms come in, isn't it? And you go, well, wow, this is what's happening here. So they get caught in this storm. Chapter 27 goes on and tells us that they spend 2 weeks into this storm. Can you imagine spending 2 weeks rocking and rolling in that boat? You know, I can't imagine that. I'd be sicker than a dog after day one, you know. But here they are. They're in this boat for 2 weeks, crossed here, going through this storm. Doesn't look good, you know. They try all kinds of things to do. They throw off gear. They do whatever they can to keep this boat afloat. 27 goes on and says, now when the 14th night had come, so we know they've been out there for 2 weeks in this storm, fighting it, as we were driven up and down in the Adriatic Sea, about midnight, as a sailor sensed they were drawn near some land, they took soundings and found it was 20 fathoms. And when they had gone a little farther, they took soundings again and found it to be 15 fathoms. So what does that mean? The land's coming up. There's land ahead. Then, fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship, when they let down the skiff into the sea, under pretense of putting out anchors from the brow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. In other words, everybody has to stay together. Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the skiff and let it fall off. Now, what happened during that 2 weeks that all of a sudden they started trusting Paul? Can you imagine? That must have been an interesting time during those 2 weeks that all of a sudden, when they wouldn't trust him at the beginning, now we see that their faith is turned and they're saying, huh, Paul seems to be 100% right, everything he said so far. And of course, he's got a great person telling him what he should be doing. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them to all take food, saying, today is the 14th day you've waited and continue without food and eating nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival. Then he says, not a hair will fall from the head of any of you. And when he had said these things, he took bread, gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. And then it tells us how many people were on that ship. How many people were on that ship? See, now me and I would have thought about it, well, maybe there was 30 people on that ship. You know, you need a crew and you got a few soldiers and you got this. But there are 276 people on that ship. Can you imagine that? 276 people. I bet 100 of them were sick, weren't they? You know, no wonder they didn't eat for 2 weeks. I wouldn't eat for 2 weeks either if I was in that kind of weather. But Paul did something unusual, didn't he? What did he do in the middle of that storm? He broke bread. He says, okay, guys, we need to deal with these tough times, don't we? So who has tough times? You know, who's going through storms around here? Whitney, are you going through a storm? Come have a chair. You know? Who else is going through a storm? Ken, are you going through the same storm? Come have a chair. Who else is going through a storm? Anybody else? Everybody's got a rosy life. Things are great. Susan, aren't you going through a storm? Trying to get your stuff together? You know? Everybody has a storm. They don't think about it. Jim just went through a storm, didn't you? Come have a chair. See, I could call every one of you up because every one of you in some way or another is going through a storm. You know? You go, well, I understand you got kids. I can understand you going through a storm. You know? And they're growing up and they want cars and they want insurance. You know? And do they? And they probably want to drive a lot, don't they? You know? See, I think none of us realize that even though Paul's out there in the ocean for 2 weeks, he had to be a word of encouragement to them. Because all of a sudden the soldiers are trusting him when they say, don't let these guys get out in those skiffs. Why? They'll die. It could lead to all of us dying. And what do? They go cut the ropes, get rid of the skiffs, force those sailors not to abandon that ship. You know? They trusted Paul all of a sudden. Well, who do we trust? You ever thought about that? Joey, you want to come up and join me? Anybody else want to come up and join me? Paul did something. He had communion. He took the time. He says, I'm praying for these people, and we're going to have communion, he says. Because he wanted them to be encouraged. He wanted them to know that he cared, God cared, we all cared for them. Sometimes we tend to get so busy we forget the storms that everybody's going through. You know? So Mike, will you come up and join us? Aaron, will you come up and join us? It says he broke bread. So can you two come over here? Can you guys come over here? It says he broke bread. He took bread. And I'm sure that in that process of breaking that bread, he had a kind of a reminder of why they were breaking that bread. You know, Jesus died on the cross for us and he gave us something we're supposed to do. It says, do this in remembrance of me. It says, we're supposed to remember why he died on the cross, why he shed that blood for us. So he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. Decide they're going to drop anchors and head to land. The morning's come. They're heading to land. And what do they see? So when it was day, they did not recognize the land, it says. But it says this, but they observed a bay with a beach upon which they planned to run the ship if possible. And they let go the anchors and left them into the sea, meanwhile losing their rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind and made for shore. But striking a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground. Ooh, lots of hope there. We're going to make it. And then the thing gets even worse than what it was before. And the brow stuck fast to remain unmovable But the storm was being broken up by the violence of the waves. How many of them died that day? None. 276 people went into the ocean, into that water it talks about where those two seas met. 276 went into that water on pieces, on whatever they can grab. Women, children, men. And when they got to shore, they counted 276 people that survived. That's a miracle in itself. Is God in control? In the middle of a storm, God is still in control. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, because we know we can trust you in the middle of our storms. We thank you, Lord, that no matter how the storm goes, you're always there with us. And what a story Paul must have been telling of those 2 weeks, the lives he must have touched to turn people all of a sudden who didn't trust him to trust him and to trust him with their very lives. Because in chapter 28, what do we find out? They wanted to kill every one of those prisoners just in case one of them escaped. So let's just kill them all. And that centurion who learned to trust Paul convinced him otherwise because Paul said, we'll all survive. We're all going to make it because God had told him. We thank you, Lord, because we know that our future is secure in you. And no matter the storm, you're there. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's power in the blood, in the blood. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, a wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for cleansing Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter and whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Since are lost in the life-giving flow, there's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Lord, thank you for this day. Light that path in front of us, Lord, and that we all walk in confidence in your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
And thank you. No, stay for the congregational meeting.